Welcome to Fridays with Fintelekt. My guest today is Ross Delston, an expert witness, attorney, and former US banking regulator. He, as I said, is an expert witness and banking lawyer with over 40 years of experience in banking regulation, Bank Secrecy Act, and AML compliance and trade finance. Ross has participated in two monitorships, that is for BNP Paribas and AIG, involving international banking, AML KYC, and sanctions, including OFAC. He has been retained as an expert witness on or litigation consultant on BSA AML compliance issues in numerous civil cases in federal and state courts. Ross has been a consultant to the IMF since 1997 on AML CFT, banking, bank restructuring, deposit insurance, bank insolvency, systemic crisis issues, and over the last many years has provided compliance training on BSA AML, TBML, and onboarding and monitoring of high-risk customers. If you actually look up Ross's profile on LinkedIn, you will find his 68-page resume there. So I'm pretty sure that my introduction to him has just been the tip of the iceberg. So with that, Ross, welcome to Fridays with Fintelekt.
Thanks very much, Shirish. And yes, I'm a very big fan of LinkedIn. So thank you for mentioning it.
Excellent. So Ross, before we get into the chat, I know that there was a public service announcement about COVID that you wanted to do. So may I invite you to do that, please?
Thanks very much, Shirish. This is directed mainly at my fellow Americans. We have been presented with a test from on high called COVID-19. Humanity has been presented with a test. And the solution is all you have to do is socially distance, wear a mask, quarantine when sick, and we failed. The vaccines came out, and over 40% of Americans are refusing to take it. The pandemic is increasing. So we failed the test, and I have no explanation except to say 100 years ago, the same measures were in place without a vaccine. And there was terrible, terrible damage to the human race. Can we avoid it now? Not answer so far, no. That's the public service announcement. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Ross, for that. And I hope people take that seriously. So, Ross, getting into the topic of discussion, AML, CFT, and the like. So, you know, the FATF has released an update in December 2020, not so long ago. That significantly improves the understanding of trade-based money laundering, or TBML. And regulators across the world, too, are sharpening their focus on the use of trade for money laundering and terrorist financing activities. What would you say are the achievements of the global community in combating TBML over the last few years? And what, according to you, are the main challenges that need to be overcome for making sustainable progress?
Well, Shirish, that's a really good question. The answer, unfortunately, is not very much. I've been involved in the TBML issue since 2008, writing about it, advising clients about it, training central banks around the world and others. Very little progress. The 2020 FATF report was helpful in terms of focus. There's a 2021 guidance document from the FATF with risk indicators, also known as red flags. I find that to be a bit more useful, but the fact is the FATF 40 recommendations still do not address this issue at all. No mention of trade-based money laundering. And you might be puzzled by that, because if you know your history of FATF, you would know that their first annual report 31 years ago, 1990, mentioned the equivalent of trade-based money laundering. Not by name, but it talked about intra-company transactions and pricing issues. 31 years ago. Progress since then in the FATF recommendations, a lot of blah, blah, a lot of reports, public-private partnership. Sure, why not? But let me see the recommendation that countries are measured against. So I proposed one, And I've written three articles on this subject. To get people's attention, I called the first article the 41st recommendation. And of course, there will never be a 41st recommendation. I heard from the US Treasury Department at that time. This was 12, 13 years ago. They said, we were frightened by your article. Frightened by it? What do you mean? Well, is this some sort of worldwide trend? Because they were unprepared. I said, no, it's just something that I thought needed to be said. And I should tell you, my proposal is very simple. The FATF edged toward it by talking about freight forwarders, edged. But the proposal is simply that everyone in the supply chain is covered by an anti-money laundering program, files suspicious transaction reports, has a compliance officer. So the big exporters and importers of agricultural products, crude oil, airplanes, you name it. Now, no one likes this. I'm happy to admit that. Everybody hates it. The director of a regional, an FATF, FATF-style regional body, FSRB, said to me, this was in a public forum, impractical, burdensome. Yes, yes, I admit it. So what's your proposal again? And as we say in the US, crickets, nothing. Crickets meaning chirping of crickets, but no voices. So, if you don't like it, let me hear your proposal. Trade transparency units, says the US government. We will exchange trade data so that we can pinpoint pricing. One, it's bilateral. There are how many countries? Shirish, do you know? It's a couple hundred?
Yeah, at least 160 in the Egmont group of FIUs at least.
Okay, but that's just the Egmont group.
Yeah.
There's a lot of countries that aren't in there, really small places. I don't know if Timor-Leste or Kiribati or some of these, Andorra, some of these small jurisdictions. Okay, so bilateral, good luck with that. Voluntary, good luck with that. Exchange of statistics. Everybody lies about international trade. They have a lot of incentives to lie. They pay export and import duties if they disclose the full extent of what they're shipping. They pay perhaps extra for weight if they disclose everything. If you saw one of my presentations on TBML, you would see pictures of container ships splitting in half. I really included those pictures because they're just great pictures. But I discovered, because I crash a lot of conferences when I travel pre-pandemic, I just wander in and say, do you mind if I look around? And if you're dressed okay, and if you're an old, unthreatening person like I am, they let you in. And I talked to people. I went into a ports conference, port something or others. I don't know if they were the people who ran ports or I wasn't sure. And I said to them, what about money laundering? Well, certainly a big problem. But another big problem is the containers are not always weighed when they're put on the ships. The largest container ships hold 20,000 containers. One ship, 20,000 containers. So if there are too many containers that are too heavy, every once in a while, the ship breaks in half. What's the significance for TBML? Somebody lied. They didn't disclose the true weight. But the linkage is lies about statistics. Everybody lies. So you gather all those lies into one place, and now you have statistics. The American author Mark Twain, about 150 years ago, 150 years ago or so, talked about that there are lies, damn lies, and statistics. Now, he was a person who never graduated high school. I think he dropped out of school to start working in what we call in the US elementary school. In other words, he was 8 or 10 years old. But he distrusted statistics. I did graduate elementary school and high school and university and law school, and I also distrust statistics. Does that mean they're not useful? Of course not. They are useful. But does that mean there's the solution to TBML? No way. Just not enough. They can be helpful, not enough. And nothing voluntary is enough. And having nothing in the AML-CFT methodology. I don't know if you heard me say that I attended the assessor training twice because it was so complicated.
Right.
No mention of TBML. There's one really interesting new piece of terminology in the 2020 report, which is trade-based terrorist financing, TBTF. Useful. I can give you some examples of it. Tobacco smuggling in Central Africa is a good example of trade-based terrorist financing.
Great. So in fact, you know, which leads me to my next question for you. You know, terrorist financing or terrorism financing, whatever you call it, has been, you know, linked to transnational organized crime. As you mentioned, tobacco, but also, you know, drug trafficking, wildlife trafficking, gold smuggling, and similar sort of areas. So do you think the global AML CFT community is actually geared up to detect and prevent organized criminal activity in its current shape and form? What do you think is going to happen to this area in the future?
Really good question. This is just an anecdote. I was invited by a non-governmental organization to speak at a conference that was a US-Pakistan conference. And it sounded really interesting. I asked if I could, actually I didn't ask, I posted the conference on LinkedIn. I said it was free. And then I got an immediate scolding email from the US NGO saying, very sorry, this is not open to the public. It's by invitation only. Why? Shirish, you're in India. You want to take a guess? Why a US-Pakistan conference would not be open to the public?
Well, they didn't want certain other countries knowing what they're discussing, right?
But one other country in particular, India.
India.
So I don't know how long that border is, but it's a serious border between India and Pakistan. There's all sorts of smuggling going on, obviously. There's all sorts of overt and covert trade. They're basically the same ethnic groups on both sides and same religions on both sides of the border. And let's face it, all of us are the same ethnic group and the same religion. It's called the human species, Homo sapiens. So no Indians allowed. Now, if you're going to solve AML, CFT, you can't have a policy that says one country not invited, whether that country is 1 billion people or 1 million people. It's just not possible. So we have those geopolitical divides. Okay, fine. We can live with that. I mean, that's just part of humanity. So what else is inhibiting us? Well, the FATF has to reach a consensus. There are no international enforcement mechanisms. They're bilateral mechanisms. They're mutual legal assistance, sure, bilateral. Again, I don't like bilateral. I like conventions where everybody signs on and there's pressure to sign on and then to implement and to adopt. We haven't done a very good job. If you have any questions about what a bad job we've done, read the Lebanese-Canadian bank case. Lebanese-Canadian bank case is a great example of what we're talking about. Hezbollah, the most successful terrorist group around in the Middle East, controls Lebanon. They started in Lebanon among the Shia. Well, at the time, this was 25, 30 years ago, the Shia were thought to be a minority. It's clear they're the majority in Lebanon. Why do we not know the answer to this? because there has not been a national census in Lebanon since 1932. Why? Because there's a balance of power among the major religious groups, Christians, Shia, Sunni. So nobody wants to upset the balance of power. So Hezbollah, in the Lebanese Canadian bank case, which is a wide-ranging US investigation leading to targeting of banks and individuals, in that case, what you see is Hezbollah in Lebanon linking up with the Zeta cartel at the time, one of the most or the most vicious Mexican cartels, mostly made up of ex-military, Mexican military. And the two linked together, covering I don't know how many continents, in a scheme to launder drug money, to ship drugs, to ship used cars from the US to Africa, and then on to other parts of the world. So it's the sort of thing you would see in an old-fashioned James Bond movie, where all the bad guys are around a table. Usually guys, these days there are a few women sprinkled in. With Hamas and the Zetas, sorry, Hezbollah and the Zetas, it's only guys. The ones with the beards are Hezbollah. And they get together. Do they have a common language? No. Do they have a common religion? No. Are they common ethnically? No. But they have one goal in mind, which is money. And on that, they are totally united.
Right, right.
The rest?
Great. So, Ross, let's speak a bit about some of the new directives or laws. So, you know, the AMLA, the Anti-Money Laundering Act of 2020, has been overhauled, is the overhauled version. Now, coupled with the memo by President Biden, the National Security Study memo published on the 3rd of June on corruption, with this, what impact do you see happening in future?
Well, the U.S. Anti-Money Laundering Act of 2020, very nice law, contains some interesting things. Basically, preserves the status quo, except in one very narrow issue, which is it creates the first U.S. national registry requiring registration of legal entities. So that sounds good. India has had this for years. India has had a corporate registry for years. I've used it.
Right.
Really, really, I mean, amazing what's in there. And it's mostly public. In the case of India, the payment of a small fee and the entry of a chartered accountant in India, you can get everything that's on the database. How accurate it is, I don't know. But that's basically a public database. US, not public. Only available unfettered to national law enforcement. Financial institutions only available to five categories. Not all financial institutions, for example, not money transmitters. They are not, don't have access to the database. So if you are a bank, you have access, but you must get the explicit permission of your customer in order to access the information of the database. Why? I talked to a staffer who worked on the bill, a committee staff person. Why? Oh, this information on who owns a company, that is just like the information about your social security number, your national ID, which is protected. This is PII. Personally identifiable information. Really? So my dry cleaners told me who owns the company. I know who owns most of the restaurants I go to. I mean, most of this, well, I'm a small business. Everybody knows who owns it. But that's PII, according to privacy issue in the US. No, it isn't. So they restricted access. Well, that restricts the utility down to, I don't want to say zero, but a number of compliance officers are saying it's too complicated to use. So they're not going to use it at all. Why would they say that? Because there are severe penalties for disclosure of ownership of companies in some wrongful way. 5 years imprisonment.
Wow.
Yeah, exactly. So why take that on? If you're a bank, you could be subject to criminal penalties and your employees could go to jail. Really? For accessing a corporate database? India, it's practically free and it's public. UK, public. EU, public. European Union, public. Why would you restrict access? So that's the AML Act of 2020, the main feature of which is the Corporate Transparency Act, the main feature of which is a beneficial ownership registry, the main feature of which is, no, you can't have it.
Right. Okay, so, you know, speaking of transparency of corporate structures and, things like that, so, you know, there is an increasing focus, right, on this transparency and, you know, many other countries, so US, Canada, the EU, UAE, many other countries are actually targeting beneficial ownership, they're targeting complex structures, identifying shell companies. Now, is this tightening of regulation and greater transparency really going to be enough to stop scandals, let's say, such as the 1MDB scandal in future?
Like 1MDB?
Yeah.
The Malaysian Sovereign Wealth Fund?
Yes.
Fascinating case. The US investigated and prosecuted Joe Lowe, one of the leading perpetrators in that case. They siphoned off hundreds of millions of dollars from the Malaysian Sovereign Wealth Fund. You can easily Google that case. And if you can't, contact me through LinkedIn if you can't find it. The short answer is corporate transparency is a good start, but until it's an EU approach, I really like the EU approach. They have required their member countries to publish a list of PEPs. I mean, that's fantastic. And then coupled with that is a public registry for beneficial ownership.
Right.
So that's the way to do it. Unless everybody does it and everybody has access, it's meaningless.
Right. So, Ross, I'd like to get your opinion on, you know, virtual assets and things like non-fungible tokens. You know, so the evolution in this space is being regarded as game-changing for the world of finance. I think even the anonymity, the speed of transactions, and the global nature of these transactions, what would you say are the implications for AML CFT going forward?
Well, what we know from studying criminals for hundreds of years is that they are early adopters of new technology. Usually among the first. So when it comes to when video cassette recorders came out, I don't know if you remember that far back, this was probably in the 80s, the pornography industry glommed onto it and everything was available first. Everything pornographic was available on video cassettes. Same with the internet. So now you have non-fungible tokens, NFTs, which are often either cute little animals or pieces of art, many of which are on the Ethereum blockchain. So that's the good news. Blockchains, like Ethereum and Bitcoin, are publicly accessible. Publicly accessible. Doesn't mean you know who is engaged in the transactions, but the transaction itself is right there. And if it's leading to or coming out of a dark web marketplace, you see that. because there are vendors like CipherTrace and Chainalysis that can track all of these things, all of these movements. There are also vendors that can show the geolocation of the machine, the computers that are using the blockchain. So you have some idea of where the user is sitting in most, but not every case. But the real issue with NFTs, non-fungible tokens, particularly the art that is being traded, is that you have a global economy for the last 10, 20 years that is pumped up with the steroids of central bank printing of money. So you've got this huge rise in asset prices of all sorts of things. It used to be just gold. Now it's real estate, it's art, it's antiquities, tobacco, you name it. Watches. I was hearing from one of my sons-in-law that watches are a hot commodity, high-end wrist watches. So all caused by this economic boom, not clear whether this is a bubble or just a boom. And then you have NFTs again. Well, everything's going to get pumped up. The price of Bitcoin is going to get pumped up. Is there going to be money laundering? There's always money laundering. There's mostly speculation. Money laundering doesn't look like a very high percentage for things like Bitcoin and Ethereum. For NFTs, haven't seen any good numbers. For coin offerings, initial coin offerings, very high percentage of fraud. But that's a specific kind of cryptocurrency.
Right, right. Great. So Ross, before we complete, let's speak a bit about things like convictions, right? So, conviction and detection rates for money laundering and terrorist financing have been really low the world over. Now, the FATF, as well as, country regulators have been asking people to shift from mere technical compliance to effectiveness. What are your views on this situation? What is the likelihood that these conviction rates and detection rates are actually going to go up going forward? What is it really going to take to get ahead of criminals?
That's a really good question, Shirish, but it goes back to the fight against domestic corruption. It's very hard to stop money laundering because so many PEPs, politically exposed persons, are involved at very high levels of national governments. That's one problem. A second problem is it's much easier to prosecute the predicate crime rather than money laundering, which is a very technical, paper-based kind of thing, tracing the flow of funds. I've been involved in some of these cases, and we had a big worry about explaining to an American jury the movement of funds and what the significance of various red flags was. Real problem. I had one case where there was a trial run of the opening case before a group of lawyers in the same office who weren't involved in the case, just to see if they understood it. These were all trial lawyers. And so the team, I was not part of this, the team presented the case and said, does this make sense to you? And the response was, no, we couldn't follow it. So imagine a jury of just average Americans plucked off the street who happen to have voted and therefore on a list. Very tough to do. I'm sorry to be to not be more positive with all my responses, but the fact is, in 21 years of my doing this work, I mean, I have four grandchildren. If they were to ask me, should they go into AML CFT, I would say to them, great idea, including the four-year-old, great idea. It'll be around when you're my age, 70. It'll be around.
Great. Well, on that note, Ross, thank you so much for joining in today. I'm sure the audience has gained a lot of insights and a different perspective by listening to you. Really fascinating speaking with you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Shirish. Thank you for having me.